When it comes to the musical side of my life, then you might not know it yet, but I actually failed terribly at playing an instrument. That does not mean though that I'm not interested. That is why I was always fascinated by the entirely electronic instrument called theremin. To play it, you simply have to move your hand back and forth from an antenna in order to control the pitch of the instrument. This way you could of course play a melody, which in my case sounds like a squeaky door or something equally annoying. So I want you to show me how to play it properly. That is why in this video I will present you how a theremin works and how we can avoid the complicated schematics available online and instead create a super simple theremin that you can build within an hour. Let's get started. When we look at modern theremins, then they consist of three main components. We got the housing, which contains all the electronic circuits, one vertical antenna, which is utilized to control the pitch, and one horizontal antenna, which is utilized to alter the volume. Both the pitch and volume are influenced by the distance of the player's hand to the corresponding antenna. But how can we achieve this electrically? Well, a circuit which is often used for this is a so-called Colpitts oscillator, which primarily consists of a bipolar junction transistor, one inductor and two capacitors, which together form an LC tank circuit. If energy would be applied to the tank circuit alone, it would for a short while oscillate between the capacitor and inductor at a resonance frequency according to this formula. But since there are always parasitic resistances, the oscillation would die off fairly quickly, which we can confirm if we create a practical LC tank circuit, apply energy, disconnect the supply and observe the occurring oscillation on the oscilloscope. That is why we utilize the NPN transistor, whose job is to provide continuous energy for the tank circuit, so that the oscillation stays stable and thus creates a sine voltage. If we would now add an antenna to the circuit and bring our hand close to it, our own body would act as a capacitor to ground and thus change the oscillation frequency slightly. Only problem is that our body can only act as a maximum capacitance of approximately 100 picofarads, which means we have to choose a high oscillation frequency far beyond the audible frequency range in order to affect the oscillation frequency strong enough to create a hearable difference. To get rid of the high, unhearable frequency though, you usually build up a second Colpitts circuit with fixed frequency, which you then send into a mixer along with the antenna influence frequency in order to create a different signal, which now only consists of the low hearable frequencies. Not complicated enough yet? Well, for the volume, we would need a similar oscillator, which this time creates a variable voltage proportional to the hand distance, which we would then feed into a voltage-controlled amplifier, along with the hearable frequency signal, in order to create the final audio signal. But before you shut off this video, screaming, "What the hell, that was simple in the title," let's remove the volume oscillator along with the amp, replace it with a potentiometer, and let's try to find a simple alternative for the Colpitts oscillators, which, like many analog circuits, requires way too many components. Here is the simplest circuit that I could find. The CD4093 IC is a logical NAND IC, while the CD4077 is a logical exclusive NOR IC. That means the two 4093s will act as oscillators and the 4077 as an adder slash subtractor. But let me explain in detail. The NAND IC has two inputs and one output, and a truth table which looks like this. Basically, the output is only low when both inputs are high. Now, one input of the NAND is connected to the supply voltage, which means it is always a logical one, while the other input is connected to a simple RC circuit. At the beginning, the capacitor is not charged up, which means the voltage at input 2 is 0 volts, so a logical 0. That means, according to the truth table, the output gets pulled high, which subsequently charges up the capacitor through the resistor. Once the capacitor reaches the high threshold value of 2.9 volts, the input is now a logical 1, which means both inputs are a 1, and thus the output is a 0, aka connected to ground, which therefore discharges the capacitor. Once the capacitor reaches the low threshold value of 1.9 volts, the input is once again low, and thus the cycle starts over again and creates a square wave signal on the output. If you would build up the antenna oscillator on a breadboard with the previously shown component values, we would get a frequency of around 565 kHz, which gets altered by my body capacitance through the antenna by around 10 kHz. The second 4093 oscillator is utilized to create a reference oscillation frequency, which we can fine-tune to the antenna-influenced oscillation frequency through a potentiometer. Next, we got the 4077 NOR IC, whose output voltage behaves according to this truth table. If we would add it to the breadboard circuit and connect the two oscillator signals to its inputs, it would create an output voltage which contains the sum and difference of the two oscillations. But since we only care about the difference, I rather removed this IC entirely and replaced it with an MCP602 op amp in a differential op amp configuration. This way, the antenna oscillation gets subtracted from the fixed oscillation, and we should get our somewhat hearable frequency on the output. Last but not least, we got a low pass filter with a cutoff frequency of 23.4 kHz, a potentiometer to control the volume, and a capacitor to remove the DC offset. And after building up this finalized circuit on the breadboard, powering it with 5 volts, connecting the output to a pair of speakers with built-in amplifier, and fine-tuning the fixed oscillation frequency, I pretty much achieved the results I was hoping for. So, to finish off this project, I gathered all the mandatory components for the circuit and connected them to one another on a piece of perf board according to the schematic, which you can, as always, find in the video description along with other details of this build. Once the perf board circuit was complete, I got myself a decent looking enclosure, drilled holes for the antenna, two potentiometers, audio jack and power jack, secured those components in place either with a bit of two component adhesive or their corresponding nut, connected the external components with short pieces of wire and partly with male headers to the perf board, closed it all up and finally gave the system power. As you can hear, it works just fine. Definitely not perfect, but it is still an interesting noisemaker that you can easily tweak to create a variety of different sounds. I hope you enjoyed watching this project and maybe learned something new along the way. If so, don't forget to like, share and subscribe. Stay creative, and I will see you next time.